See, abiding in Christ in its simplest terms is accepting Jesus into your life at the very simplest term. But in order to feel joy, it's important that we create a relationship with Him and model our life after His. In my own kind of devotions and studying, I've been looking at a lot on the topic of joy. You know, in the world that we live in, to try to figure out how to maintain this joy in the midst of trials or circumstances that you might find yourself in right now can be really, really tough. You know, we find ourselves to be in so many different situations sometimes, and we can feel so many different types of emotions. But joy is one of the most prominent benefits of being a Christian. It's also one of the keys to live life to the fullest, because there's just far too many things in your life, in my life, in the world that seem to take away that joy, that happiness that you feel on a daily basis. From small things like spilling your coffee on your lap on the way to work, all the way to losing someone that you love, or a divorce, or friendships that leave you, or fear, or anxiety, or worry, or suicidal thoughts. There's so many different things in life that work to kind of just take that joy from you, it feels like. And sometimes it's difficult to keep your mind focused on what truly matters. See, no matter what, you're gonna always find a reason to be sad, a reason to be happy, a reason to, in the life that we live, it's easy to be those things. But to maintain joy under every single emotion that you feel, even the negative ones, is where it takes determination and responsibility and purpose on our part. And I want to share a few different points that I feel in my studying within the Word of God that I've seen that these are the three things that are going to make a massive difference in your life when it comes to experiencing joy. Number one, abiding. Abiding in Christ. Abiding in Christ is one of the easiest ways to experience joy. Abiding simply means to live, continue, or remain. So to abide in Christ is to live in Him and remain in Him. When a person is saved, he or she is already described as being in Christ. You can see it. But so accepting Jesus into your life is one of the first things that you need to do in order to start this abiding in Christ. But abiding goes much deeper too, because it talks about our actual obedience. You find throughout the Bible that abiding has to do with you being obedient to God as well. And John chapter 15, verse 10 to 11 says, "If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full," in this translation. In a different translation, it talks about your joy being complete. See, when I think of the word complete, it is something that's all-encompassing. It means you're missing nothing. It means that you're good to go. Being complete, if I said, hey, I have all the pieces for this board game, it's a complete set. You'd look at me and go, okay, that would, to me, means that you're not missing any pieces at all. If we're playing cards, or you've played cards in your past, there's something, it really is not very fun when you realize that there's a few cards missing. It's not a complete set. But if you have a complete set of cards, a complete deck of cards, there's not one card missing. See, when we have complete joy within Christ, there's nothing missing in your life when it comes to experiencing joy. Your joy may, or God's joy is in you, and your joy may be complete. See, in my life, I would absolutely love to experience a joy that is complete. Experience a joy that in the emotions that I might be feeling throughout the day of sadness or anger or frustration or happiness, whatever it is, that I can still maintain joy within my life. See, abiding in Christ in its simplest terms is accepting Jesus into your life at the very simplest terms. But in order to feel joy, it's important that we create a relationship with Him and model our life after His. We see this in the Bible as well. It talks about following in the steps of Jesus, acting like He did, living like He did. In 1 John 2, verse 5 to 6, it says, "We know that we have come to know Him if we keep His commands. Whoever says, 'I know Him,' but does not do what He commands is a liar, and the truth is not in that person. But if anyone obeys His word, love for God is truly made complete in them. This is how we know we are in Him. Whoever claims to live in Him must live as Jesus did." See, in this, you hear about obedience in abiding, as well as the other side, as doing what Jesus did when He walked the earth, when He walked on the planet. See, when we start to act like Jesus, that is where things start to really fall into place for us, because acting like Jesus, we've talked about this in a few different messages. When you act like Jesus, Jesus was someone in the world. He walked the planet. He was a human being. Yes, he was the Son of God, but when he came to earth, he acted in the same way that we did. He had all the temptations that we had in our life. He had all the feelings, all the emotions, the pain. He had blood like us. He breathed like us. Everything was the same. And so for us to model our life after Jesus is actually pretty important, because Jesus lived a phenomenal life. Yes, maybe he had times where he had to pray and really get God's peace and strength within him, but he was able to live a life that was amazing, an amazing example for each and every one of us. So like this verse says, whoever claims to live in him, or you could say whoever claims to abide in Christ, must live as Jesus did. Number two, spend time with God through prayer. This is one of the most simple things. You probably just looked at me like, really, that's your second point? Yes, it is. Because in the Christian life, I have found so many different areas where people are nervous to pray. People don't know what to say. People don't know how to pray. It's like it's the biggest nerve-wracking thing for them if someone were to ask them to pray in public. That to them is just like, nope, I cannot do that. There's no way. See, but when you start to pray, and you start to pray in your personal life, it begins to really connect you with God even deeper than you were before. See, there's a reason that the Bible says pray without ceasing. It's not physically never stop praying, because you know you couldn't do that. But it is to carry this God praying attitude with you everywhere that you go. That's what it's about. It's about every waking moment that you live in life is to be lived in awareness of God, and to be aware that he's with us and that he's actively involved and engaged in our thoughts and in our actions. See, when our thoughts turn to worry or turn to anxiety or turn to discouragement or anger, see, we are to consciously turn every thought into prayer and prayer into thanksgiving. When we start to do this, not only to become more grateful for what we have, what has already been done for us, what our relationship with God is, we actually are able to focus more on the positive than constantly focus on the negative. See, as we go through the day, prayer should be our first response to every fearful situation, every anxious thought, every undesired task that you feel God is calling you to do. A lack of prayer will cause us to depend on ourselves rather than depend on God's grace for you. And I mean, let me ask you this. Where do you get your strength from? Where do you get your energy from each day? Where do you get your peace from? And I'm not talking like, oh, I have a coffee every morning, that's where I get my energy from. No, I'm talking about like this deep inner energy, this deep inner peace, this deep inner strength to carry on in the midst of whatever it is that you're going through. Because if that's why you should pray, but if you don't, that's where you start to find yourself depending on yourself. And when you start to depend on yourself, you start to step into this avenue of going through things a lot harder than you would have had to go through them, experiencing things a lot more of the emotions like sadness and anger and frustration, and not having that underlying joy within your life. See, when you pray and you talk to God, it's so that you can remain in him, as well as direct your focus on that thing that you want, that strength, that peace, on God, on the scriptures. See, like in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17, it's like I said, it says, pray without ceasing. This is an attitude we must have in our life. If you're going through your day, maybe you're feeling stressed at work, and that prayer is as simple as, you know what? I thank you, Father, for your strength. I thank you for that strength within me, the strength to press on, to handle anything that comes in my life. I thank you that I am calm. The words that you say are far less important than what the prayer actually is and what your heart is. You know, when I was a kid, my dad is Pastor Leon, and he would always pray for me, my mom as well. And then their prayers were so fluid that I was like, these are the best. He's quoting scripture, he's doing all these things. And I'm like, this feels really good. But then when I started praying and learning prayer, I was like, I'm not even close to as good as that, even close. I don't know, have as many scriptures memorized as them or anything like that. But the more I dove into this, it's not necessarily what you say within prayer that means the most to God. It's the heart that you come to God with in the midst of that prayer. I don't care if you stutter through every prayer that you pray about yourself. I don't care if you forget the words. I don't care if you forget the promise. I don't care if you forget the scriptures that you were going to quote in the prayer that you had. It's all about you just coming to God with what your heart is saying. You know what? I just need you, God. That's it. Whatever words come to your mind in that moment are the ones that mean a lot to God. And if you have a scripture to throw in, do it. That's great. It's awesome. Number three, rely on community within your life. Rely on community. See, Ecclesiastes 4 verse 9 to 12 says this, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie together, they keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him. A threefold cord is not easily broken. See, every time I pray, when I'm emceeing on a Sunday or on a Saturday, I'm praying for the needs of this church, and I'm praying and sharing these stories of praise reports or these testimonies that have come in, I always remind you of a couple of things, and it's because it helps me a lot too. But one of the biggest things is to remember that you have people around you, that you're not alone, that here at church, we want to be alongside you, praying for whatever it is that you're going through, being there alongside you, whatever it is that you're experiencing right now. Because believing that you're alone is something that really messes with you. The Bible says it right here, that it says although a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand against him. And a threefold cord is not easily broken. See, when we have this community around us, when we have people around us, when we have friends that believe the similar things to you, it really just amps you up and encourages you. Same thing goes for when we pray over the needs or pray for any prayer requests that you may have. For you to know that we're here with you, that you have a community of people, a family of people alongside you, and whatever it is that you're going through, it helps you go, I'm not alone in what I'm going through. I can make it through what I'm going through. And I'm going to make it through this. You know how many times in my life that I've received a text from a friend at a time that was the best time to get that text from that friend? It could have been just, hey, thinking about you. I'm praying for you right now, whatever it may be. And that really helped me. It could be in the moment of feeling like you're not encouraged. It could be in the moment of forgetting that you need to pray more in the midst of what you're going through, or just to remind yourself that, hey, your thoughts are not even close to what God wants you to think about. You're thinking about the negative. You're thinking about death. You're thinking about all these things that are gonna actually come into your life. And you're going to end up experiencing things and not being able to figure it out because this peace, this strength that can remain inside of you is so prevalent when you focus on God's word and focus on what it says about you. But finding community is crucial. Finding a church like this to be able to call home, to be able to have people around you that believe similar things to you, that they can help you with what it is that you're going through, it is crucial. When you have that community around you of people that believe in you, believe in the same thing that you believe in, and can help encourage you and lift you up in times where you're struggling, it helps you so much. See, relying on community is something that's going to change your life if you allow it to. See, and if you find yourself right now not experiencing joy, ask yourself, what of these three things that I talked about today are you not doing? Because I almost guarantee that when you're not experiencing joy in your life, I bet you it's one of those three things, whether that you're just not remaining in Jesus, you're not abiding in him. Maybe it's because your prayer life is just completely down and out and you're not even doing it. And so you have to remember to pray to God and talk to him and bring your requests to him and talk to him about your life, because those things help you refocus. And of course, if you're doing those two things, maybe it's just because you're in a tough time sometimes, and to stay encouraged by yourself takes a little bit of effort. And having a friend or a community or churchgoers alongside you that go, hey, you can do this, you can make it through, is all you need to just start stepping and start running towards again and having that life filled with joy.